Now we started with experiences, next we came to belief, and I will tell you maybe about quite something else, or maybe it's exactly the same. It will be about a theoretical approach to how we can do research. Also about experiences and beliefs, of course. The aim of developmental psychologists is to study development. I learned that a TED talk should always start with something what's easy to understand. Studying development, search for change, differs in several ways from study, for example, of differences between groups, differences between reaction times. That seems evident, but it is often overlooked. And in this talk, I want to elaborate three basic rules that we need to study development. In developmental psychology, we want to know how people develop from one stage to the next, from infancy to toddler to school child, etc., until old age. We want to learn how people learn, how they develop skills and traits. And typically, the way in which we study development is to take a group of people, to assess them with regard to some feature, and to reassess the same group at a later time. In this way, we learned many relevant things, for example, about the age in which certain skills and traits typically emerge, and we learned, for example, that toddlers are not capable of several abstract thinking skills, while in early adulthood, most adults do master these skills. We also found in this way that many skills develop over time in a kind of S-shaped curve, like this. This is a curve of the development of some abstract reasoning skill during adolescence. In pre-adolescence, the average level of the skill is about zero. None of the children masters the skills. And around 18, most of the adolescents do master the skill. What does this tell us about the way a single adolescent develops? Let's take the case of Thomas. His teacher has assessed his abstract reasoning skill every year, and at age 16, Thomas still does not show any sign of development. His graph looks like this. Based on the general graph in the upper corner, we may expect that Thomas should show at least some development. Of course, we know that some children are ahead of others in development, but Thomas seems to have an exceptional and atypical growth pattern. But is that really true? Can we make assumptions about individual development based on the knowledge of average group data? In fact, we cannot. Let's have a look at the other children in Thomas's class. Now there seems to be a slight change. Dehedia, yeah. In the graph, I showed the individual trajectories of each pupil separately. Each colored line represents one child in the class. I represented the trajectories very abstract, and you don't see them all because some of them show overlap. As you see, the individual development shows a very different pattern. The skills develop within 1 year, and quite suddenly. The black line, again, shows the average level. So, in this case, the average development is misleading if we want to know how an individual child develops. And that is to say the first rule of how to study development. In order to understand development, we have to assess individual trajectories. In this example, the individual curves are not just variation around the average, but they are completely different. And that's not only true for the shape of development, but also for other characteristics. Take, for example, the factor structure of data. In group data, the factor structure is often different from the factor structure in longitudinal individual data. For example, the Big Five. These five factors emerge again and again in many different groups of people. However, factor analysis performed on individual longitudinal data give quite other findings. Many individuals have a big 2 or a big 3, but not a big 5. That was the first rule. The second rule, and now I have to promise you that it will still come, because that will be elaborated in the speech of Heidi Meindertsma. So for now, I will just give a very small summary of the second skill. And it says that to grasp what is going on in development, for that we have to look at different time scales. We have at the one hand to look at the time scale of real time, so a micro level time scale, and at the other hand we have to look at the time scale of development, the macro level time scale. You will have to wait for some more hours to have that explained, but be patient, it will be here. And then I will go on with the third rule. To illustrate that, I will describe the development of 2 adolescent girls who start to learn statistics. I will call them Marieke and Lilian. They resemble each other in terms of age, previous learning experience, and intelligence. And here we see their development. The red one is Marieke and the blue one is Lilian. One of them reaches the highest level of statistic comprehension and she becomes a successful statistician. The other one shows no development at all. And in fact, in the end, she stops believing in statistics. How could that happen? To understand this, we will zoom in on what is actually happening in the first lessons. Heidi will also again explain more about that. We see that both girls start in a comparable way. However, Lillian shows a strong decrease in performance in the fourth lesson. Of course, such things happen. A headache, relational troubles, many reasons for a one-time bad performance. But sometimes, especially at the beginning of a course, such more or less random events may strongly affect the course of development. Shortly after that fourth lesson, Lillian's statistical comprehension stops growing, and at the end, she has the same level as when she began. What happened exactly? Research has shown that in many ways, the support of the environment matters. Support from friends, feedback from teachers, provide messages that reflect a positive or negative expectations and valuations of a student's skills. And we just learned in the first presentations that information from others is very important in how you see the world yourself. And that also happens here. So the way in which other people see Lillian and Marieke will reflect in their ways they see themselves. In research, these contextual characteristics are often assessed as if they were stable. For example, if we study Marieke and Lillian, we may assess the levels of support of both girls at the beginning of their course. You can look at the green and the blue line. They represent the levels of support of both girls. And in the beginning, they look comparable. However, as we all know, context is not stable. Important others react to what's happening, and they change their opinion and their feedback according to the behavior of the person. Context, in fact, is as changeable and dynamic as the individual himself. And they both interact in every step of the developmental process, and thus both change during that process. In this graph, we see that although both girls initially have a comparative, supportive environment, the bad performance of Lillian only in lesson 4 changes that trajectory and results in a decrease of the support. This affects Lillian's self-confidence, her effort, and subsequent performances, and a negative self-strengthening feedback loop sets in motion. And now, it is especially relevant to realize that this interactional process, with its mutual interactions and resulting changes and fluctuations, is not white noise. It is not error variance because of some exceptional event. In fact, it is the core mechanism of development itself. And we can see this only if we study the context as dynamic and as changing in the same way as the development as the person himself. And that is the third rule. Now, I want to summarize. In order to study development, we have to study individual trajectories. We have to study both the micro and the macro level. And finally, we have to study the context as a changing part of the system. Thank you.